And welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters Toronto. How are you guys doing? This place is getting super hype. So many people standing in the back. We now have people sitting in the front. I love it. Hey guys, we're pretty intimate right now. You're slightly below ball level. We have a crazy match coming up. Our second quarterfinal, another best of five. First Kevin to bring to the stage. We gave him an epic intro earlier. Don't really think we need to top that. He is, from KT Rolster, the greatest guy who's ever lived, Flash! And his opponent, from Norway, who has been crushing the Koreans this tournament. He is now known as the Korean Killer. He came all the way out of the open bracket. In the group stages, he did not drop a map against some of the top Koreans in the world, including two-time champion CJ Entis Hero. He's dropping GSL champions. He's dropping Intel Extreme Master champions. He beat the BlizzCon champion SOS, the world champion Intel Extreme Masters SOS. And right now, he told me just backstage, he's gonna come up here and beat Flash. Please, scream for Liquid Snoot.
And here we go then. It's quarterfinal serious time for the foreigner, and he is the lone survivor right now. Gents, it's all on Snoot to save esports.
That's right. Snoot has said time and time again when we ask him, what would you rather face? It's always Terran. Always Terran.
Yeah, always Terran, and actually he wanted to play Flash.
Yeah, we kind of talking, I was like, well, you know, and we had this chat backstage, well, which of these players can go the furthest? And you think, if Snoot plays against MC, you know, Snoot was telling us earlier he's played against him a lot, despite defeating several, as Jared was just telling us, world-class Protoss players, Snoot still doesn't like ZVP.
No.
Which blows my mind, because when you'd rather play Flash than the race that you just beat two world champions of,
I think all
you
of
must
us,
be confident.
All of us would be very happy if we could play ZVP the way that Snoot plays ZVP, that's for sure. All joking aside, Flash has made the last eight for the first time at Intel Extreme Masters. He said to me in the last time I spoke to him, I'm fed up with coming to IEM and all the other events and finishing in the round of 16. Yep. He's finally got out of that. Now he's in a more sort of familiar territory. He likes these best of fives. He likes being able to mix his play up. So is this going to suit him more than it's going to suit Snoot, even though Snoot's ZVT is extraordinarily good?
Yeah, I think Flash is an experienced Brood War player, an experienced competitor. Snoot's been playing for a long time, but few people have been playing for as long as Flash has. The longer he has to familiarize himself with his opponent, the better off he's going to be. And we saw that in his series against MC. First time he faces him, loses 1-2. You know, the games were, even the game that he won, it was kind of like, well, and then he faces him again and crushes him 2-0. And clearly, Flash had figured something out about playing against MC.
Indeed. Nathan, it's an extraordinary match for many ways. You and I were talking backstage. Whoever wins this is kind of like the crowd favorite going forward, in a way that, you know, Snoot, he's the foreign hope. If he wins, great. But we think he might not have the better chance of going the whole way if he goes through. Whereas if Flash goes through, you almost kind of believe the hype. He could probably win it all if he wins this one.
Yeah, we know that Snoot is phenomenal. He's had a great run here. But going further, you still have to worry about players like Tasia. And I feel that when we get into this series, Flash has the most momentum before this tournament. I would still say during this tournament, and were he to get past this into the semis, I'd say he still has the most momentum, and I would dare say he's the player that I get, like I was telling you, I picked him to win this from the very beginning because he's Flash, and voting against Flash is usually a bad idea. But Snoot wanted this. We got to see a bit of his style used by Scarlet against Flash yesterday.
Yes, we did.
Flash did not have any difficulty with this. However, he got himself a couple of early leads in those matches as well.
Yep. I'm gonna just say that was a very weak form of that style. Yeah. Clearly, Scarlet had not practiced it very much. I expect to see much more refinement out of Snoot doing that. And coming in here, I don't think Flash... He's definitely have mentally prepared himself, maybe talked to his teammates a little bit, discussed what he might do, but I don't think he's really ever experience that in the same way that Snoot's about to do to
him. I mean, as you rightly pointed out, Nathan, he had a little bit of it from Scarlett, but he's going to get the full force today. I mean, we've moved this match up, and I'm not going to kid you, there's a very good reason for moving this match up today, because this could actually be a long best of five.
Yep. If this Swarmo style develops in the way that we predict it will, and when we saw him use it against Masa, the games ended relatively quick after the Swarm Host entered the field. And that had a little bit to do with just Masa wasn't keeping pace with Snoot in the early game, and when the Swarm Host hit the field, Masa was clearly not prepared.
Yep.
I don't think that's going to be the same thing here.
Okay.
And it's easy to see how that might end up in longer
games. MC earlier said the key to beating Swarm Host in PvZ is to stop them getting there in the first place.
Yep.
Similar scenario for Flash?
It seems like the simplest solution is just don't let it happen. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, gents. Let's head over to the commentary team for a very, very monster match between two crowd favorites. Snoot versus Flash with Kalaris and Apollo.
The last remaining non-Korean here in the top eight now goes to battle. It's do or die for him. He needs points. He's in the top 16 right now, but he needs to solidify his position, and he goes up against the one player he wanted to play here at this tournament.
This is a big, big game. A massive series that we're loading into now, Kalaris.
All right, let's get it on. Game number one, spawning down to the south. The Blue Terran representing KT Rolster. It is Flash. And up to the top right, he's your red Zerg. He's representing Team Liquid. It is Snoot.
This is the biggest game of the tournament so far, quite easily. A massive game now. The last remaining non-Korean goes up against the crowd favorite, a tournament favorite. Flash has been on a roll recently. He's been destroying every player he's run into in recent times. He had a slight hiccup versus MC in the group stages, but he corrected his mistake. And already, Snoot gonna start this series off, this best of five series off with an early spawning pool. He's gonna be looking to get the cancellation on that command center, which we know Flash is gonna throw down, whether it be command center first or a Reaper following with that command center.
And the thing is that you bring up a good point. The way Flash adapted from Series 1 to Series 2 against MC is very important, because this is a best of five. This isn't something as fleeting as a best of three. Yeah. This will give time for Flash to adapt. If he is greeted by the similar style that we've been seeing from Snoot against his previous Terran opponent, and Snoot has been touting this style. He's been saying, this style is strong. I want Flash.
Flash has a buckets loads of experience, unbelievable amounts of experience in best of five and, of course, best of seven scenarios. He's a champion. He, you know, was the best Brood War player that ever lived. He's a god, as they say. That's why he has that nickname, Kalaris. He's going to have a lot of experience coming into this best of five, when to change his strategies up, how to change the pace of the series, and we'll see if Snoot can keep up with him here. Snoot, likewise, has a lot of experience, too. But look at that. The Reaper's going left. The Reaper going left here, and that means that Snoot's going to get down onto that command center, and we're quite likely to have it cancelled here, and it's going to be a very good start for the Norwegian.
Yeah, very good start, as he now enters the natural in just a second. The Reaper poking around, doesn't really see a natural. Unfortunately, he knows he's gone the wrong way.
Hello, Flash.
Lings greet him to the best of five, force him away from the command center. It probably will end up dying if he's not careful about that, but he's already going to work on the command center. How is he going to deal with this with no units?
Flash does not want to cancel this, but he has to.
Oh,
a good start here for Snoot. Very, very good start. And that, I'm sure, he's only going to feel, you know, feed him with more confidence.
Yeah.
He started off this series well, and we'll see if he can continue that way.
Flash is going to continue just microing this Reaper, making sure that it doesn't die off to these Lings. But whilst it's damaging the Lings and having to deal with those, the Reaper isn't over the other side, gathering information, trying to threaten any drone kills there either.
Righty-ho, that is true. But we see a gas taken by Snoot quite early on. I don't think we'll see too much from it. He does have the options to be aggressive with it, but
yeah.
Not too sure we would try to do something like that. But we know Flash's playstyle coming into this series. If you don't, I'm going to explain it very briefly here. Flash's playstyle. There's nothing really special about it. He just does everything perfectly.
Yeah.
There's no cute tricks. There's no weird build orders that he's going to throw in. He's just going to do what he does best, and he's going to nail it. He's going to have more units than most Terran players do. He's going to consistently be waypointing units over to you that sometimes you aren't going to be, you know, good enough to defend because you aren't as good as he is. But Snoot is going to have to really match him in this series. But Snoot does have a very unique style of his own. He likes to get up to the traditional Zergling, Baneling, Mutalisk. He's capable of all-inning, but more importantly, once the game reaches, you know, the 15-minute, 20-minute mark, Swarm Host will be used.
Yeah.
Flash does not have experience against that, especially in this matchup. And he looked a little bit shaky when we saw Scarlet doing it. But Klaris, Roach Warren down.
Mm-hmm.
Roach Warren this early is... It definitely couldn't be aggressive here. He's building two overlords at once. He's showing Flash that he's looking to take a third. 10 Lings are on the way. Snoot is going to do this.
So many overlords popping.
Snoot is opening up his supply to build an army to go ahead and try to bust the front wall of Flash immediately.
Well, this is interesting because right now behind that, it's triple command center, two engineering bays following this up as well. So a very, very greedy start here from Flash. Snoot is just playing against everything that Flash expects, really, in this first game. And this could hit hard.
Yeah, this can hit hard. This can do a lot of damage. Ooh. But Flash's Reaper enters the main base. If he sees these roaches popping, and he's going to have a look in here, and he's going to be like, all right, well, why isn't a gas taken here? Zergling Speedstone, that's his second gas. Wait a minute. Does he click, though? Does he say that this is going to be aggression? Because there is the Imperialness to join this all together. No bunkers to scan,
the scan.
On the natural. Sees roaches.
Yeah.
A beautiful scan hit by Flash. Just, he was feeling it. He wasn't sure. And now he is. Bunkers are starting. He needs more than one, trust me.
Oh yes, he does. That's going to be a lot of Lings, a lot of Banelings, a lot of Roaches hitting this wall. And he's wisely kept the Hellions as well back. He needs to have as much firepower as possible because he never had that many units to begin with anyway.
Two Widow Mines on the way, two Bunkers. Is he going to have enough to defend this in time? Stim is not even that far away either. And depending on, you know, does this work or not? It's going to be map number one.
Yep.
There are no transitions from a game like this. This is everything.
Not at all. This is a lot of gas invested here for Snoot to try and break through. As now, where the Baneling Nest is just about to complete. He's working on these rocks on the right-hand side with the vision that Overlord's providing him there. And that's quite a few Banelings morphing in for Snoot. His army supply, 44 against 24.
There's two Widow Mines right behind that bunker. If they connect onto these Banelings, they are not going to do the damage that Snoot needs.
Mm.
Oh, Flash moves down. He checks this. How's this going to work?
Oh, okay. Baneling's gonna walk on up. How much will they bring down?
It
takes down the first bunker already, but that first Widow Mine gets a lot of kills there. The Hellions still retain their lives, and the SCV's trying to repair this next bunker. He needs to keep that alive.
He needs the bunker alive. So far, so good for Flash.
Trying to hold on once again. All the damage is being done here to the Roaches. They're really not holding on too strongly. He's got quite a few worker kills, only about six. But in the end, the bunker refuses to die. Flash will not let it go down. The Reapers are slowly dying.
He won't let it go down, but he will lose every single SCV in defending this. And meanwhile, Snoot has made a transition. He's got drones on the way, and he's done 16 worker kills here.
Yeah.
16 pushing Flash down to 30.
That's a lot of damage done, a lot of damage overall. Even the Lings just keep flooding in. And actually, they could break down that bunker now with the SCVs off the repair all.
Oh, they get back on it, though. He's going to keep this bunker alive, and Flash maintains this hold.
Very, very well done. But still more Lings actually pile on in behind that. Another 10 drones in production.
Flash makes the hold.
But can he keep going any further? Well, he's going to keep going, that's for sure. But against an economy of 55 workers to 31, at least he opened up pretty greedy himself, right, with a third command center, double engineering base. So his 1-1 was already finished during that, I think.
Snoot, when going for an attack like this, is very far behind on upgrades, lair, anti-air.
Yeah.
Right now, Flash should be, I'm pretty sure, lifting that medivac up full of units and just being aggressive. He needs to be thinking about dropping and doing damage, because without any Mutalisk around, there's nothing to stop the medivac from flying around and doing damage to get him back into this game. Remember, he is on three command centers, so he does have a set of mules to try to recover, to try and find a way to stabilize and get himself back in momentum and get the machine working once again here. But 57 supply, obviously not very good against 92 here of Snoot, and the upgrade's coming in, and Snoot's not even that far behind with them.
Yeah, a lot of Lings on the way to push this back. Lair isn't even finished up until just now, and this drop is not going to do anything. So Flash is looking for opportunities and can't find them just yet. But still, his macro is doing pretty well, out everything considered. Three SCVs on the way at any given time. Seven Marines. 2-2 has now started as well.
Incredibly tense game here to start this series up, and best of five just makes me smile thinking about it, because this is going to be one to remember for sure. Medivac coming around the back here. Any form of damage he can get is worth it. But Snoot playing a very strong game. Look at this creep spread already here.
Yeah, I was just about to mention, that gives him a really good solid position on this. These medivacs trying to go from point A to point B, from the third to the main, you just get spotted unless you want to go around so far. And also, shutting down all the creep on these avenues is going to take a whole lot of time here for Flash.
But the machine is working once again here, Kolaris. Flash is climbing up in supply, and it's so scary and weird to see. From being so far behind to then start to equalize the supply count. He's at 99 now. Snoop's only 109. Flash is just able to consistently hit his supply depots, consistently build a lot of units at the right time, and he is slowly building an army to start to get damage done. He's killed a couple of overlords here and there.
It's not a bad start. That Widowmine might do...
Well...
I mean, you can leave as many Zerglings there as you want, really. Right. 10 kills in the end.
And then this one on the right-hand side here. Mule is still not in this game. That's the con of going for such a strategy here, but Lings and Banelings doing the work.
Yeah, Lings doing the defense. Well. Lings just kind of on top of any drops that go down here, and in the end, with all these Marines trickling out, yes, he's trading Marines away from Lings, but I mean, not many Marines.
Snoot has a lot of Zerglings. 65. Look at them streaming through the middle of the map here while he's defending at home.
Yeah.
Flash has got to be careful here that he doesn't have any units just caught out in the open like these. He's got to think about trying to pick these up. He also played depots down as well. He can get into the SCV lines from this.
Uh-oh. Oh, a lot of Marines still reinforcing, so eventually maybe he'll be able to chew through all of that. It was. It could have been close there. I mean, if his macro wasn't on point, he wasn't hitting those Marines.
Yeah, those Lings didn't really do anything there, so that wasn't too good for Snoot, unfortunately. Well, he traded off against a couple of Marines, but lost quite a lot there. But the Mulists are into the game, so Snoot's going to start to try to rise that Mulist count up. He's got to start picking off the Medivacs. They are the most important units to kill as a Zerg player here. They're going to tie up your starport, they're going to tie up your gas, you've got to get rid of them. But of course, he's going to start getting some good fights here. 18 Bane's getting morphed. The flying V of Flash as he moves forward with his Medivacs here. Doesn't have any Widowmines really with his army. He's fully concentrated on Hellbats, so his splits have to be good. Snoot comes around for a counter here.
I mean, this army's quite strong. He's got 26 Banelings against 29 Marines and not a whole lot more. He's actually going to break down the bunker at the third base here, try and do a little bit of damage to that economy, and try and swing in from the back with the rest of his army. This is an interesting little move here by Snoot. Has to pull him back.
Not too sure what to make of that, really, because he didn't get into the SCVs, and once again, he's trading off a little bit against Flash. Yeah. But I mean, it was trading off semi-equal here, and he also bought himself time to 2-2, so I guess it can work in his favor a little bit here. Infestation Pit is down. We know what we're going to see from that, more than likely. We are going to see Swarmers come into play. The attack upgrade coming in for range, which is, of course, the same attack upgrade that the Swarm Hosts are going to use. But Flash, 3-3 on the way.
That's
Blue Flame on the way.
That's really, really fast considering the position he was put in earlier on. He is a little bit supply blocked here, but now he's also mixing in a four or two to make sure that those Mutalists can't have free reign over an army location, as I'm very interested to see how Flash is going to deal with this. If this game goes on longer, how is he going to deal with the transition from Snoot?
Well, if you kill Snoot before he even gets there, that's how to deal with it, but right now, he doesn't quite have the army size. Snoot, 16 Mutalists here. Swinging around there is the Enduring Locust upgrade. Swarm Host now officially confirmed. And Snoot finding a bit of damage done with these Mutalists. Picks off a couple of Marines, a couple of Hellbats.
And all the while, this is keeping Flash back home. This is saying
absolutely,
you have to
time.
Defend against this whilst the five Swarm Hosts are now on the way.
Creep spread, of course, looking marvelous. Overlord spread now coming in. Snoot is... You know, there's no doubt, Snoot is the best non-Korean. He's playing an absolutely fantastic tournament. He's beaten CJ Hero twice. He's beaten SOS. And now he tackles Flash. But can he get one step further than he did in the Intel Extreme Masters Shenzhen, where he lost to Jadong in this very quarterfinal? But here we do see Banelings, most importantly.
Where are they
squeezing
going?
Squeezing through.
Trying to get to it, but a good retreat out there by Flash. Only the bunker goes down in the end, instantly replaced there by Flash to make sure he's okay over.
Swarmos numbers now starting to really rise, and that's the big part of this game. Snoot's been running around, buying time, using the Mutalist well, and the Lings and Banelings, and even coming in here, Flash can't, he can't get past the halfway line.
No, exactly. I mentioned it in the previous series for Snoot playing against Massa, the Mutalists, they are the sword. They're trying to stab constantly. While whilst he's poorly protected and defended at home by the Swarm Host style, he's also finding room on this left-hand side as well against Flash in the third.
Yes, this is a very, very good game here by Snoot. Super aggressive all over the place, keeping Flash back. He's bought himself time to get the Swarm Host out, and Flash now sees it. But how is he going to approach this? Does he want to start trying to drop? But then you got to think about the Mutalis. A few of them did die, but they're being replenished. Six more are coming in. Does he want to bulldoze it? If he wants to bulldoze it, then he needs a 200 supply army. He needs Hellbats to do splash damage versus the Locust to break the waves to get closer and closer. But at all times here, Snoot's ready for this.
Yeah, all the while, if you're going to try and bulldoze, there's still this reinforcing army here for Snoot to actually pin up against it and hold it down. Yeah.
And Flash needs a fourth Glarus, right?
Yes.
His main is almost run out. He's got to start thinking about where is he going to take a fourth, but he's still thinking about how to fight, not how to expand.
Yeah, you bring up a great point. I mean, where is he going to do that? If he does, the Mutalists are still sharking around, having a look to do some damage here and there.
Well, 3-3 is done, and this is the push that Flash wants to try to break Snoot with.
If this might be the push. It has to be the push, potentially here, as the Lings of Banelings are here to actually reinforce with this. Few connections here and there, but that's a lot of Banelings that are already gone.
If Snoot destroys this army, he will win this game.
Yeah, basically, there's a few Banelings up to the top as well, pushing against that Bioforce. There's actually not that much bio left over. He needs to drop the scan. He needs to kill these Swarm Hosts right now.
The Banelings!
The complimentary Banelings killing off a lot of those Marines. The Swarm Hosts now, some of them have died off, but as this continues, there's no scan.
180 supply to 120 right now. The natural has been sacked by Snoot. He is defending against the army, and Flash just simply doesn't have enough money to rebuild this type of army.
He can't do anything. Now he doesn't have enough to press up against those Swarm Hosts again. All the reinforcements are being picked off by the Mutalists here. Snoot is actually crushing the army.
GG!
Game number one goes to Snoot here against Flash, the guy that he wanted to go up against in this tournament. Remarkable start.
It's a dream start from the very start with the six Zerglings. Everything went his way. And the most important part is, I suppose the phrase is, this guy's mortal. You know, he can be stopped. Yeah. And that's very important for Snoot, because as much as he was confident, there is always nerves. There is no such thing as a player without nerves. You're going up against a legend of StarCraft. Not just StarCraft Brood War, not StarCraft 2, just the legend of RTS even more.
Yes.
He's just beaten him in game number one. He knows he can do it now. He knew backstage, but now he's confirmed he can beat Flash. And we're going to see what Flash can do to stop this. And is the hype around Flash, all these performances online, in Pro League, in the GSL, he's meant to be this Terran savior right now, but he's on the stage versus a non-Korean. And think to this, Kolaris, one last point. Mm-hmm. Think back to Brood War. Non-Koreans couldn't even come close to taking a map. Couldn't even last 10 minutes against this guy.
Yeah.
He's just lost first map. Imagine losing the series, and imagine what he'd be thinking too.
It's very rare that he even has to play against non-Koreans. And now he's down 1-0 in this best of five. Game number two now in the round of eight. Let's get into it. Spawning down to the bottom right-hand corner. It's the Blue Terran representing KT Rollstar. It is Flash. And oh boy, oh boy, up to the top right-hand corner, one up in this series, representing Team Liquid. Give it up for Snoot!
The hype is real right now. This, as mentioned many a time, is the series to watch. Make sure you tell all of your friends to come watch this right now, because this is going to be one to remember. How's this next game going to go? Snoot opened up with an early spawning pool, caught Flash off guard, so he did gain an advantage there. Mm-hmm. But coming into this, it's a massive map now, Deadwing. Quite a bit different from Merry-Go-Round. Merry-Go-Round, a three-player map, quite smaller. We saw the way that Snoot played it very smartly there. Because of the way the three-player map works, you can come around both sides all the time and harass and slow Flash down. This type of map, with the size of it, of course, is the most important part, but second of all, the bases that Flash are going to take, there are no run bys here, really.
No.
You know, there's three easy bases to take. There's an easy fourth for Flash to take. So, that would say to me that this map, I like it for Flash to do well on.
I mean, as long as he locks down the perimeter on the north side of his main base, it's going to be very difficult for Mutalisks to really do a whole lot around there. It's going to be more about pinning down the natural, which, again, he can kind of use extra anti-air to just be able to deal with that if Snoot's going to use the same style. But I feel that game number one for Flash there was his feel-out game, right? He doesn't have too much experience against this style. That was his just normal go-to, right? 3-3, push, see how this fares against it. Okay, didn't work. Game number two. I'm not too stupid at this game. I'm going to maybe try something a little bit different.
I feel that Flash needs to stop Snoot before it's too late.
Yeah.
I can't help but feel when Snoot is in the position with his Swarmos out, you know, he's working on the Hive, he's going towards Ultralisks and, you know, the later tech of Zerg. At this position, I just don't think he's beatable right now until you start to figure it out, especially for Flash, who just doesn't and hasn't played against this style.
Yeah.
It's a very difficult style that Snoot plays to deal with as a Terran. And right now, I think that if the games do go long, that's where Snoot's going to be comfortable. But again, it comes back to the original point. This map, Flash should go unhindered. He should go untouched on 3-4 bases, and he's going to build a big army fast. And it may be so fast that, you know, Snoot won't be at that point in the game where the Swarmos are out.
You're entirely right. I mean, imagine the previous game without those little kind of mishaps, those little, like, tickles and prokes and prods. But that being said, Snoot did commit to that Ling Roach Bane attack as well. So it was a little bit set back in how he wanted to really play out the mid to late stages of that game. So we'll have to see going into game number two.
Ooh, this Reaper's got two kills here.
Wow.
Yeah, it's done rather well for itself, but without building any links, excuse me, you have to be expected to take a loss or two.
Oh yeah, of course.
I mean, you can't really just defend without links here. And if he gets his third, I'd be quite surprised. But the Reaper is a little bit low. Flash did go in and scout that the gas had been taken. He did scout that Zircon Speed is on its way. But Snoot took out a gas when the Reaper was there and has gone back in. And unfortunately, this Overlord looks like it's going to get picked off here.
Yeah, there's not much room for that to get away from.
Oh, it's going to be close. It's going to be close.
Oh! Well, you called it pretty close.
it was going to be close. One hit point left. Snoot's still mining gas right now, but I think he's just building up towards his evolution chambers. And it is going to be more of a normal game. Actually, I say that, but he's chosen a Leia here.
And he pushed away the Reaper at such a time there that it wasn't actually spotted.
Interesting. And I think that, okay, this is a really cool move from Snoot. He's chosen the Leia because that Overlord which survived, and I think this is correct, spotted that a second gas had been taken, which means that he's more than not expecting like a Hellion Banshee play.
Yeah, yeah.
And if we're going to see a Hellion Banshee play, then really fast Mulus can instantly shut that down because you don't have anti-air. And obviously, Hellions and Banshees are going to get destroyed, but it's a tank, and it's a medivac. And you know what's going to happen now? Is Flash is going to drop that right behind Snoot's natural. There's a position where Lings and Roaches or anything cannot get there. He'll start doing damage to the Extractor and the Mineral Line. You know, the saving grace is that the Spire is going to be on the way, and it will be able to deal with it. But how long is it going to take to get the Mulus out?
Yeah, it'll take a little while, that's for sure. We have Snoot here just getting his Baneling Nest, preparing for kind of the later stages of a normal game right now. And all in all, he doesn't fully know about this. It's there's already moving out into the middle is the medevac.
He's got no idea here. Absolutely no idea. It looks like the Baneling Nest has been thrown in here just for safety caution. I mean, for safety precautions, if there was to be some kind of movement out from Flash and maybe he didn't have, you know, the right units, but we're going to see this drop come in, and Snoop's going to be like, I don't have anything to get to this right now.
Yep, Spire is going to take quite a while, that's for sure. Spore Crawlers are going down, but after seeing this kind of little move, this is a lot of gas focused down this path, so Spore Crawler might not be too useful in this situation.
Yeah, nice move here by Flash. Really, really nice move.
Yeah, good map for him to be trying to take a little bit of an advantage back on, that's for sure. A lot of Lings in production here, but they can't really do a whole lot other than retain that third base down there, and this is just free denial of mining time here for Flash.
Yeah, this is very good for Flash. He's got a bit of damage done. On the other side of the map, there was an Overseer from Snoot, went in and had a quick look around. Is there a third command center? Is there extra barracks? And he didn't actually see anything. So the Overseer technically should want to go back in to find out if there is going to be extra barracks as we are seeing in. But one of the important things here, Clara, Snoot has hidden the fact that he's gone Spire. Flash doesn't know.
Yeah, you're right.
So he's got to be careful about Mutalisks. I mean, he's going to clear up the tank quite fast, and maybe that'll be enough time to build turrets considering the engineering bay is done. Oh, shortly, we'll be done.
Yeah, he's got to be very, very careful about this. The Mutalisks arguably are just going to fly over and try and clean up that on the left-hand side. But if he chooses to go straight, then he could do some damage. So it's like, you know, which do you really want to do? I think Snoot here probably wants to get to economy.
I wonder if Snoot's going to try and bust his opponent. I think he might here.
We're just a strong Ling Bane.
Well, he hasn't got Evolution Chambers. He's focused on getting the Zergling, Baneling speed. He's got a lot of Lings and Mulis out. What happens if he just ignores the tank and goes straight for the natural hit?
He could. Well, the attacking's been spotted in the middle as well.
His draw count's so low. I should have noticed this a little bit earlier, but he's going to try and win the game now. Something quite good for Flash is that he doesn't have a rush third command center here. But he's got to start building defense at home. He needs more bunkers. I don't think he realizes what the hell Snoot is doing. There's 10 Banelings coming in.
Yeah, and there's also, Flash kind of understood a little bit. He actually did a little bit of damage to the this mineral line as well with the Marines, but here comes the attack. He's got a few units behind here, also repairing these Hellions. He knows that
he doesn't know this is here.
All right, breaking through here. The bunker wasn't even full during all of that. Here comes the flood through. If he can kill off the Marines, the Mutalisks can do a lot here. And there aren't even that many Marines left over, actually. Snoo trying to break on through, but the missile turret
the
pushes him away.
The wall is open. The Zergling flood is on its way. Look at the mini map. They're going to come down. He's going to go to the natural, and Flash has just been completely surprised here. That's so important to keep that turret alive, obviously, for the Mulis here.
Trying to kill us off some of these Hellions, because if the Lynx can get through there and do some damage, then he'll be in a really, really good place. Trying to get out as well from those Marines, but
that one Widow Mine,
he has to be very, very careful about sticking around, and he actually does get hit there. Doesn't do a massive amount of damage, but still, Flash trying to hold on.
God, Snoot is playing so aggressive this series. Is Flash going to be able to hold on to this like he did in the previous one? He's pulling SCVs, the Link Flood is here, he's supply blocked, he can't really build anything. No way is Snoot going to go up 2-0.
He has six Marines out right now. Six Marines. That one Widowmine still hasn't even recharged. One Sea Tank on the other side of the map.
He's been broken.
Snoot is doing so much damage. 41 Lings on the map, and they're just camping the infrastructure. He can't make anything to be able to deal with this. Everything dies as soon as it comes out.
GG!
Oh my god. Snoot is able to go up two games over Flash here. Wow, what a start for Snoot.
Wow. This is a dream coming true right now for Snoot. He's up 2-0 versus Flash. He's got three games. He's got three games now. He has to lose three in a row to lose this series. And the way that he's playing, I don't even think he's going to lose one.
Yeah, I don't think so either. This is now do or die for Flash. Flash is one game away from being eliminated from the entire tournament by that man right there, Snoot, who showed his normal style in game one, and then game two he was like, I'm just going to completely flip this on its head.
I cannot believe how good Snoot is playing at this tournament. It is the best performances we've seen from him in a very long time. He's been playing so well over the last 6 months. He's on stage in the quarterfinals again. Last event, he lost versus Jadong, but this time he's up two games versus Flash. One single game away from going to the semifinals, getting the top four. And remember, the most important part about all this, Snoot wants to go to BlizzCon, and he is doing everything that he can to do so. And by beating Flash here, he gains more points. He has an opportunity to go even further. This is absolutely insane here at the Intellectual Masters.
Crazy stuff. He has the opportunity now to clean sweep Flash. If he does that, he goes on to the round of four, where he plays against his teammate Tasia in TVZ. All right, let's get into this. Game number three now, as we have a ridiculous series on our hands. Spawning down to the bottom right-hand corner as our blue Terran representing KT Rolster, it is Flash. And up to the top left, what can I say? As our red Zerg representing Team Liquid, it is Snoot!
It just seems every move that Snoot makes, you just can't go wrong. It was a beautifully executed attack there. Flash had absolutely no idea it was even about to happen. If he knew, he could have had more bunkers. And to be honest, I think he probably would have held it. But he had no idea until it was at his front door. And he got brutalized there by Snoot. And this is history in the making right now. Snoot could 3-0 Flash on the main stage here. And the best part about all of it is he said yesterday, he said today, I want to play Flash. I want to beat Flash on the stage. You know, I've beaten MC multiple times before. I actually want to beat Flash. And right now he's doing it.
Yeah. And when a player like Snoot, who is, you know, when you normally talk to him, he's quite a mild-mannered guy, you know? He's not really too up on himself or anything like that. He's a humble guy, and he just says, well, actually, yeah, I actually can beat Flash. And now he's 2-0 up against the man.
And Snoot unbelievable. Is going for the six circlings again. He's got the spawning pull down first. And he's going to attempt the cancellation on that command center again. And if this was any other Terran player, keyboards would be smashed if the command center got cancelled once again. This is a very frustrating thing to have to deal with. The Reaper's on its way. And we will see these six circlings very, very shortly here as well. If this works again, just a simple trick. The six circlings early, bringing them around and hiding them from the Reaper to get a cancellation. It's pretty big. Well, actually, look at this. He didn't build the circlings. He built the Queen first.
Hmm.
I wonder if he was expecting maybe a two barracks. Look at the Overlord path as well on the second Overlord.
It's a really good point.
The second Overlord at the back here went in a weird way to then go and sit itself there. I think he was expecting that Flash tries a two barracks to get into this instantly to get back into it.
That's a really good evaluation, considering especially the Overlord path. I mean, from here on out, I think that Snoot feels pretty confident. I mean, he felt confident before the series, but now two up, he's going to feel extremely confident. So deterring anything like that from happening in this series is a very smart play by Snoot.
And Snoot has the Overlord inside the main base, and this is a very good Overlord, because what it's going to do for Snoot is see that second guess now, but also see it later. Snoot should be sending the Overlord right now, and then he's going to hover it outside Flash's main base, and he'll be looking at that gas at all times. This could change his strategy here. Depending on what he sees, if he doesn't see a gas, he knows that Flash is probably on three command centers, and with a gas already been taken by Snoot, there are options to be aggressive. There are options to play very greedy as well, knowing that your opponent's on three command centers. Yeah. And if he sees the second gas, he knows he's going to play against something more tricky.
Well, Snoot for now moving out with these two links, having a little look around down to the south there at that third location, just in case Flash was trying to sneak that in down there, doesn't spot it. We'll stick around there for just a little bit longer as Factory's being added on as well for Flash. I really feel he has to seize the initiative, do something here in these series. Otherwise, Snoot is just going to run away with a victory again. And Flash doesn't want to be 3-0'd here. He wants to win. He wants to go into the round of four. He wants the victory. But Snoot right now is that roadblock.
Yeah. Yes, he is. A single Zergling on the other side of the map is going to attempt a bit of a scout here. Good deny from Flash. And he's chosen a starport here and Hellions. The starport here could build a Viking to destroy the Overlords outside. He could actually go Banshee after the Viking as well and start to ramp up the aggression. It's also very good defensively too if he was to go Banshees after that. But it's a medivac here, so he's actually going to drop, by the looks of it, maybe Marines. I think he'll drop the Marines and then run around with the Hellions and try to get to Snoot's natural. And Snoot currently doesn't have any units. He's only got Queens and drones.
Yeah, a lot of drones.
So this could do work.
Yeah,
and especially through the middle of the map, notice probably why Flash chose this. You can't have Overlords in the middle of the map because they just got shut down by Marines quite easily.
Yeah.
Which means he's going to have a hard time spotting this even happening. Which then means he's going to have a hard time building units to stop it.
And also, you know, the ramp is very, very wide open on a map like this, unless Snoot starts to close that off. Here comes the medevac, though, moving across the map to begin this onslaught.
Well, and there's still no units, so this is actually going to do damage here. There's only Queens, and there's not that many of them either. There's only three. There are going to be four and five in a quick second here.
He needs a really, really good defense here with minimal that he has actually to his name. Double Evolution Chamber. He's actually walling off. He's walling it off fully. He knows that there's an imminent threat. Has to pull drones to actually deal with the drop here. Does not lose the Queen. Good micro out, but he's going to lose a lot of drones.
And the Queen on the wall.
Trying to hold off against that, but the Queen is dead. It's gone. The Hellions block the ramp as well. A really good move there by Flash to get himself back into this series. There goes the Queen. More drones gonna die off, and Snoot has just been blindsided in this game number three.
Yeah, this is a very well executed strategy here by Flash. He's dealt so much damage. He's killed almost every single Queen. He's killed all of the drones on that natural, and this is critical damage. This is really critical damage to Snoot.
Really good start by Flash in game number three, just constantly pushing on forward. It's gonna be very difficult for Snoot to continue the recovery off. Thankfully, he had the Zergling speed, so he can push that away, but it's from now on for Snoot, it kind of has to be drones, drones, drones. He needs to replenish.
Absolutely. He's hurting. He's bleeding right now. 27 drones versus 37. Flash has his third command center on the way. He's got Stim on the way. A very good comeback in this series for Flash. Nice move.
All right, double engineering bay behind that for Flash, just really capitalizing on his advantage now, knowing it's going to be a little bit difficult for counter-aggression to really do anything, and even finds an Overlord on the left-hand side here to just try and really, really annoy Snoo. Anything he can find here is a brilliant pickup.
Yep, double engineering bay even before additional barracks, knowing that Snoo cannot be aggressive. He has to replenish his economy. He needs to be building drones. There is no reason whatsoever for Flash to even think about anything other than upgrades and building a lot of stuff that isn't units.
He likes his macro, let's face it. He does like his macro, so may as well go back to that. And he even has his token Viking on the right-hand side looking for extra overlords. So, again, really putting a dent in the Snoot stride.
Yeah, so Snoot's going to play this game from a pretty big deficit here compared to obviously where he'd like to be, which means it's going to be a lot more difficult than every single game he's played so far because every game he's kind of had an advantage. But this one, no, Flash carries the advantage. So this kind of comes down to Snoot outplaying Flash in the next 5-10 minutes to, you know, try to get back into it. He's got to take a good fight somehow. The problem is the Leia's really late, which means Bailing Speed's going to be really late. Mm. The Mutalists are going to be very late. And Flash is almost ready to push out soon. He's got his medivacs on the way. Combat shields will be ready by the time the medivacs are out. And to be honest, he may even be close to 1-1 as well. Is Snoot going to be able to defend without the crucial units he needs?
It's going to be very difficult. He needs to, once a push actually comes along, he needs to get a good wraparound. He needs to engage from multiple angles. He's already heading off down here with a lot of lings to have a look
he's
around.
He's putting a lot of lings.
It's
very confusing. He's up to 60-odd lings here. So the runarounds are possible. If Flash moves out, Snoot can move in. And if he builds enough lings, then he can deal with what Flash has and also do the counterattack. 21 Banelings.
He has no idea about this. He actually has no idea about this entire army down to the bottom left-hand corner.
No, he doesn't. And this is interesting here. 21 Banelings. Yeah. There's only Lings right now. Only Lings. Snoot is choosing something which he obviously needs to do a lot with. And it could work.
Where are you guys going? Where are you going? I mean, he has to deal with
Flash
the army on the side.
I mean, yes, that's the other part. He needs to deal with the army on this side. Flash doesn't even realize, he doesn't lift the wall.
He actually breaks down part of the wall to make sure that reinforcements can come in here, and he's going to get a lot of workers if he's not careful there. Flash, you need to split that up a bit better.
But
there's so much damage being done on the other side.
Snoot has to defend over here too. He needs to do both, otherwise this won't work.
Oh, Leia falls. That's really not good here for Snoot. Trying to do as much economical damage as he possibly can do to try and even it up. I think he fell. This was his only opportunity, thinking that he couldn't take the army head on.
If he destroys Flash's army somehow, he can still win this, but there's a lot of Hellbats in here.
26 workers against 38. He's actually pulling the drones as well. He tries to deal with this. Good splits by Flash to be able to dodge some of those Banelings. Oh, it's only drones now. Only drones and queens going at this army. Flash with the Hellbats is just absolutely ripping it apart. But at the same time, Ling's trying to do something at the other side.
Flash is starting to defend back at home as well. So as cool of a move this was for Snoot to try to get back into this because he knew he was playing from behind, it looks like Flash should prevail here. He's building 9 Marines at a time. He's got that third base, giving him a lot of resources to be able to defend back at home. And Snoot just doesn't really have anything here.
No, not at all. This all snowballed out of control very, very quickly from a little bit earlier on. And now Flash, well, he's laid waste to the natural. He's laid waste to the main base. There's only the third that's really mining a little bit here for Snoot. But he has no lings left. He has very little left.
Yeah, this looks like Flash will be able to put a mark on the scoreboard in his favor over Snoot. Snoot is running dry. He's lost his Banelings. He has minimal units. One last attempt at a defense. 4 Banelings. But this is a very simple split here for Flash. Target down the Banelings, and you're going to take this game.
GG! Flash takes his first map here in this best of 5. All important. Has to win 3 games in a row, or 2 now, to make sure that he can go into the round of 4.
It's not going to allow that 3-0 to happen, and we have a game on our hands.
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
Flash could take advice from that. He's let a few units in.
Raise your depots.
Well, Nimbus is going to be our next map between these two. A map that's very big. Hard to really make lots of early aggression work out. As in very, very early aggression. You just don't know where your opponent spawned. So Let's see what Flash is going to do here.
But of course, with Snoot's fantastic start in this series, he's still just one game away. Just one game, and he will always be just one game. But right now, if Flash is able to tie this up, it would go to the decider, the fifth and final important map here.
And all you have to do is think back to how Snoot played against Massa in this very tournament, on this map. Actual just dominating control of the map. Flash is going to want to look to finish this quick, I feel, because that game was just pretty terrifying from the opposite end of the spectrum.
Yeah, usually in this matchup, Terran versus Zerg, the Terran player needs to be very careful of different types of Zerg attacks. There's a lot of different types of roach bailing attacks, but that's even if Snoot wants to try something like that. He may just say, whatever, man, I can beat you later on. And then, of course, Snoot would be the one wanting to see what Flash is up to, because Flash tried something, and it worked out very, very well there. Very well executed. Wow. And we'll see which way this is going to go now.
Big moment for this guy. A big moment. If he can take this one map to move on to the round of four to play against Tasia, that would be absolutely massive for him. So let's get into it. Game number four. Flash has been able to take one back. Can Snoot make it the 3-1, or do we go to the final game? Spawning up to the top left, it's our blue Terran representing KT Rolster. It's Flash! And down to the bottom left, one game away from the round of four, representing Team Liquid, give it up for Snoot!
Right. Game number four, Nimbus. Whew. It's been a very good tournament so far, this one, of course, here in Toronto, the most amazing city. I'm still without trying poutine, though. That is on my to-do list. Don't worry.
Same.
It's on my to-do list. Don't worry. It's good, says Infeza. Thank you very much, Infeza, by the way, for all you're observing so far in this tournament. You've been doing a very good job back there.
That was for you, Infeza.
All right, so we have a Reaper opening here by Flash, just the barracks and the gas once again. And we do have a hatchery first by Snoot. Here's a funny question.
Okay.
If we go to game five,
yes,
depending on the map, I actually don't even know what map it's going to be. Could would Flash two barracks to win it all?
Yes, he could. Yes, he would.
Yeah?
Yes. Yes, he... I mean...
Imagine that.
Would MVP do that? Yes, he would.
Of course he would, man.
So, Flash here in StarCraft 2, he'd do it too. He'd do it too.
That's something to look out for sure in that final game. There's Flash's ruler to the right there. Brings it wherever he goes.
He needs a custom ruler. He needs a KT Rolster ruler. That'd be pretty sick. That'd be cool.
All right. Gas been brought in by Snoot, so he's going to work towards Zergling speed here. Options technically available to be aggressive, but on a map this big, it's kind of difficult to be aggressive, so it should be just Zergling speed and then try to save up. He could go for something like the fast layer. He could be looking at double evolution chambers or, for his double upgrades quite early on. But Flash is just going to do a bread and butter build here, very textbook, Reaper opening, and then with the gas after the Reaper, you throw the reactor down, ready to build a couple of Marines, ready for the switch up of the factory for the Hellions, and meanwhile, of course, throwing down that command center. Snoot building four links, not wanting to take any drone losses against this Reaper.
Yeah, pretty important. Taking the back door, the back expansion during all of this. We've actually seen him take front expansions against other Terrans in the past on this map. Yep. Try and get that creep spread going really, really fast from the front. But this game, not opting to do so.
I think this is a perfect map for the Swarm Host style.
Yes.
It's ideal, actually. But I'm just following this Reaper. Hasn't managed to get any kills yet. Good micro from Snoot, bringing back the low health Zerglings there. And he hasn't lost a single one yet. Absolutely brilliant control there by Snoot. Very, very well done.
Buying time for the Queen, pushes it away.
No Zerglings lost, no drones, nothing. Beautiful micro. But yeah, going back to that point, it's a beautiful Swarm Host map because he can take three bases, which are very south here, Snoot. Maybe the fourth to the right. But the forward siege in the middle of the map here is going to be so difficult for Flash to deal with.
Yeah.
So definitely, the longer the game goes, I would definitely favor Snoot. But Flash on a single gas currently is going to be looking for the Starport again.
Is he going to go for the Marine Hellion?
Same build here. Could be the same build here, going straight towards that natural, of course, just flying south. Would drop the Medivac Marine and Hellions there.
Snoot's going to have to be careful. He spotted his opponent very early on with the Overlord, so that's nice for him to start things off. And he could even fly in there with that and have full information. I'm wondering how actually... Oh, well, those two Marines are causing that a little bit of problem, of course.
This is a big problem for Snoot. He doesn't know what the hell Flash is doing. This could be a classic Blue Flame Hellion build. It could be the same build that we just saw. It could be three command centers. He's got no idea. And the one Overlord that's close on the left cannot get close because of the two Marines, or closer, should I say. There is one other Overlord, which is to the top right, which isn't going to find information fast enough. Yeah. Because he's still got to go all the way to the main base here to see the key structures. 16 links!
Whoa.
16 links on the way here. And he's already got quite a few out.
Well, he just saw the Hellions at the front, so maybe he's sniffing out the idea of what's about to come.
Snoot's working on gas as well. He's got 130 here.
Yeah.
That's a lot of links that he's building. Overly safe. I think it's almost impossible to deal damage with them, so... That counter here?
I guess... Oh, he's going to go all the way around. Very far.
He's going for a counter, but he doesn't know what he's playing against, so his natural's exposed. The medivac's there.
He didn't go all the way around. Oh, unless he was going for the surrounding anyway. Oh!
But the drop on the natural. His units are on the other side.
He needs to get back there as quickly as possible. Yes, he dealt with the Hellions in the middle of the map, chasing those away, but now losing maybe a few workers here and there. How many has he already gone down? He's lost five, retreating out from there. Good start from Flash, but losing the Hellions, it kind of takes away from the 1-2 punch of this build.
Baneling nest down and 40 more links.
Uh-oh.
I think he may just go for the counter.
Well, he killed off all the Hellions. All he has to do is push this away now. One queen getting transfused. Good save there. The links filter through, forcing this back. Does he know about everything? Does he know about the Baneliness?
No, he doesn't know about that. But more drones are being built, so he's not continuing to build more and more Zerglings here. But good harassment there by Flash. Unfortunately, just because Snoot couldn't scout and he got caught off guard here. But are these going to be morphed to Banelings?
Is
he
going to
morph these to Banelings?
There's only seven Marines and two.
Snoot!
Uh-oh.
Right outside the front door here. Flash does not have a lot of units. He's still harassing. He's got double engineering, but he's got a couple of Hellions at home, but he's got no idea.
He needs units. He needs units there for the wall completely. That's a lot of Banelings.
Oh my gosh, if he breaks this wall and gets into that SCV line.
His supply block, he needs to get unsupply block and then have more money.
Here we go.
Uh-oh. All right, well, that's going to fall pretty fast. It's actually crippling a little bit of the production
here. He's got a micro's Hellions well. The Hellions are key to defending.
If he keeps those alive, he should be all right during all of this. Supply blocked a little bit, but it's only links, only nine links in total. The majority of them aren't even there. Good defense by Flash.
Yeah, I mean, that's quite simple, actually. You just keep the Hellions alive, and you're going to defend that, and the wall is rebuilt there. So, unfortunately, Snoot struggling a little bit in this game, and we see Flash still dropping on the other side of the map, and Flash is ramping up the pressure, ramping up the heat here in that third and now fourth game.
50 workers, well, 49 now against 42. Technically in favor of Snoot, yes, but Flash has done damage behind this. He's adding on three extra barracks, and he has that third command center down as well. So...
1-1 upgrades, Medivaxer gonna start in a second, Stim on the way, lots of production. Snoot not even starting his evolution chambers here. He's very far behind in this game.
I mean, the evolution chambers, you mentioned them completely. 1-1 will be three quarters done before the evolution chambers are even really kind of into their swing of things at 1-1 themselves.
Well, in the last game that we saw, Snoot was in a similar position, and I think he's actually worse off in this game. He went for an attack and was like, all right, this is it. I'm going to try it, and if it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. He can't do that here. Yeah. He's too far behind to make that work. So where does he go? How does he find a way back into this? Does he have to drag it out long to finally get towards the swarm host? But if he tries that, then he must not die to the pushes that are going to come, and they will come soon.
Yeah, he could just get crushed by the macro here of Flash. He's going to try and do some dropping on this left-hand side. The Viking's already got three kills itself. So again, just really kind of... forcing Snoot to replenish what he really doesn't want to have to. He wants drones, he wants units, not extra overlords having to be built here.
And Snoot is really going to be hard-pressed here for the next, for the rest of this game, simply put. And Flash does not need to commit here. He does not need to go in because he doesn't need to do more damage. He's already got the damage done. So if he went in there, he'd lose units and actually allow Snoot to crawl back into this one. So all he needs to do is sit back, build an army, and kind of walk over the other side of the map and take a fight. And the fight would be heavily in his favor, which is the problem that Snoot's going to have to encounter. With such a late lair again, the same problem from the previous game exists. No bailing speed. Banelings are so key.
Yeah.
They have to get on top of the Marines, or the Marines are going to kill everything.
And this creep spread's really important as well, because look how far we are into this game. The lack of vision for Snoot is really going to start hurting him if he doesn't push it out further. Yeah. But Flash is already here. He's knocking on the door. He's saying, well, where's your creep spread? Oh, it's this far back? Okay, then. I'm just going to keep on doing what I need to do, sitting around.
24 Banelings. That's how many Banelings he needs to defend this. He may try and stop this and then go for a counter, but Flash has got the wheel moving now. He's got a lot of units on the way. Hellbat's being added on. 2-2 being started. And unless he loses these units, we're going to run into the similar scenario as previous, where Snoot tries to do damage, but he can't do damage, and he can't defend either. So Snoot very, very much troubled here.
Fourth base denied. That's a lot of Banelings. Without centrifugal hooks against this army, it's going to be hard for them to really do a whole lot.
Yeah, this is, the way that they played out, it's just heavily, heavily favored to Flash. And Baneling speed on its way. That's where he can start to defend properly. But until that is done, that's another 100 seconds on that upgrade. So unfortunately, he's got quite a while to wait.
Spire now on the way. It takes a long, long time, as you say. With that 2-2 now started up, technically, you know, Snoot is actually trying to catch up with the upgrades, but it's going to take a long time. Yeah. And Flash, he's just setting the perimeter straight.
And Snoot's trying to get up to Swarmos quite fast here. He's going to sit on three bases more than likely and pray to God that he doesn't die before that and build enough Swarmos to win the game. But
That little thing that we just saw there is Snoot style to a T, right? He's like, well, I can't put the creep tumors anywhere else. I guess I'm going to have to try and find another angle. And he does, but it's a desperate angle, a very desperate angle here as Flash is set up camp, set up shop right outside.
He's waiting to pounce. He's building so many units. He's 2-2 upgrades are almost complete, and this is just a classic ending to a game. You wait until your upgrade's complete, you have a good army, then you go kill this guy.
And this is, I mean, Snoot, this is not where he really wants to build in Swarmos, right? He wanted to be in a much better position than this. So Snoot is really up against it. He knows it. He's trying to find a solution to a problem that maybe he doesn't encounter all too often when he's using this style.
But Flash has allowed Snoot to get to Baneling speed and allowed 6 Swarmos to enter the game. But Enduring Locust is not ready. Flash is going to be ready now. The upgrades are only going to be like 10 seconds left from completing, and that's when he's going to go in. And this is going to be an incredibly difficult hold for Snoot. Here we go. 2-2 is done. Flash is going in. Can Snoot do this? I'm not too sure he can. He's so far behind in supply.
Yeah, the army supply is huge. 138 against 70 here. Snoot is going to have to create the miracle defense. Bailey's going to come from the right-hand side, try and crush through a lot of these Marines. They actually get quite a lot of them during all of that. But the Swarmos on the left-hand side were scanned, were shut down on the right. Flash now laying waste to that third base. He even found the fourth base on the right-hand side as well, so he is all over Snoot right now.
We are going to be going to game 5 here. Snoot is not going to be able to win this one. Flash has pulled 2 games back here, and he is destroying everything that Snoot has. He's up hugely in supply, and this was just a perfect way to end the game. No mistakes, no nonsense, just wait, then strike at the optimal time. Unfortunately for Snoot, his defense is not good enough.
GG!
Game 5 will happen.
Wow. It took the very last Swarmhost for Snoot to leave that game in the end, but he knew for a long time that he was down and out there. And now one final game will determine this. Who moves on to the round of 4 between Flash, between Snoot? This is fantastic.
Flash's experience, not letting nerves get to him, being 2 behind in a series, no problem. I know you've got 1 game to win, but it doesn't faze me at all. Just going to win the next 2, and then we're going to go game 5, and then we'll see how well you can do under pressure. And of course, if you want to join in the discussion, make sure to tweet with the hashtag IEM and join others in talking about how awesome this series is and how awesome this tournament is and will continue to be, because we are only, this is obviously very weird to say, only in the quarterfinals right now of this tournament, with the winner here and this very next map going into the semifinals, and will face off against Liquid Tasia. Flash versus Tasia, Snoot versus Tasia. We'd be, of course, seeing a classic Team Liquid kill there.
Mm-hmm.
And then before that will be happening tomorrow, of course, we'll be going into the other quarterfinals today. We have 2 more games after this, hopefully. We'll see how well the schedule works, because this has been an awesome game and an awesome series so far. But now the pressure's on, and Snoop not happy there. He's shaking his head. He knows that he had this in the bag. Just a single game, but Flash draws back up. Foxtrot Labs, the final map here.
Mm-hmm. And I've got to ask, is Flash going to do it? Is Flash going to do it? It's Force Cross spawns.
Yeah.
He knows where his opponent is.
Does Snoot open up spawning pool to stop the double backs, which he may think are coming? Something tells me that Flash would not risk his tournament on that.
Yeah, I think at this point,
he's played well. He's playing well. He's going head-to-head with Snoot. He's gaining advantages. He's finishing the game when he needs to finish the game. If he was to go two barracks and it fail, which we've already seen Snoot go for protection on that.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't even know what he'd be thinking. He'd be kicking himself for sure.
Well, let's get into it. Game number five, the final game in this series to determine who moves on to the round of four, as we have spawning down to the bottom right-hand corner. He's tied it up. Game number five, it is Flash. And up to the top left-hand corner, started so well in this series. It's gone a bit downhill. Can he do it? The last non-Korean here, it is Snoot!
Which way will this end? We either have the last non-Korean in the semifinals, or we follow the road of Flash to his first big StarCraft II tournament win.
Yeah.
Which way will this go? Of course, after this, Liquid Deja is waiting, so there's another big obstacle in the way. But we will follow this very closely, and it's something to keep track of, not just today, but for tomorrow on the final day of this tournament. No two barracks, Kolaris. We have the Reaper opening for Flash.
Mm-hmm.
And what is Snoot going to do? Is he spawning pool here? Is he hatchery first?
Well, overall, I feel Snoot, after all that has been said and done through this series, I feel Snoot is just going to go to the build. The build. No tricks early on. No messing around. This is his opportunity now to advance on. One last game, but he had it the whole time. He was playing around with ideas of trying to kill off his opponent early. But this has to be the game where he brings out the best transition into that swarm host style possible.
Spawning pool first by Snoot. A little bit worried about that two barracks here. He could try those six Zerglings once again, where he could swing around and try to get towards that command center. We'll see which one he chooses here. Because obviously as the spawning pool finishes, Queen or Zerglings will tell us.
And overall, now just have this hatchery on the way. So a very normal opener here from Snoot to start things off.
Yeah, it is the Queen, so a little bit worried about that two barracks. He'd be more than fine dealing with it if it was the case. With the spawning pool first down. And also, the difference between hatchery first and spawning pool first is not that much difference anyway when it comes to the economy.
Mm-hmm.
Gas thrown down here for Snoop, so once again, he does have multiple options available for him when it comes to using Zergling speed earlier on.
Overlords were covering a lot of the angle down to the south during this game at the very, very beginning to make sure that something wasn't going on down there. Obviously, there are other angles to be able to take something like a T-Rex, but for now, look at this. Flash is a little bit scared about the potential Lings coming along to deal with that command center.
They're starting to know each other very well.
Yeah.
Which, of course, starts to really highlight the awesomeness that is StarCraft, that we see players mold their strategies towards each other a little bit more, and we see the games develop from one map to another. A lot on the line here for Snoot, not just this tournament, but of course his BlizzCon too. He's only just now got into the top 16. He's currently sitting at rank 13. He's only 200 points in, and 200 points is nothing. It's absolutely nothing, really. So a loss here would definitely hurt his BlizzCon chances.
And what do you think here, Sean? Do you think Flash goes for the Marine kind of Hellion push that he's been doing? Because, to be fair, in this game, but there's the second command center as well.
The thing is, Flash is, in the last couple of games, he's noticing that Snoot is trying a lot of weird things.
Yeah.
So Flash is probably just going to play a very normal game, very heavy on scouting, make sure he knows what Snoot is doing, because I think he's going to feel confident in going toe-to-toe with Snoot. I think this game could be a very long one.
Yeah. especially at this ultimate point where it really, really matters now. Snoot had some games, some little leeway, but there is none of that anymore.
Snoot is mining a lot of gas. I'm a little bit worried because, as I say, this game might go long. Well, what is he going to do? Is he just going to save it here to throw down the double evolution chamber? Just get his... it's a Baleen Nest.
Uh-oh. Six Lings on the way. That's another gas going down as well here.
Oh, boy.
Snoot is going to really open up the taps very, very quickly if Flash isn't careful.
Yeah, this is...
16 Lings.
Whoa, Snoot. This make or break, Sunshine. 16 Zerglings on the way. Baleen Nest coming in. Flash goes in. What did he scout there? I didn't actually see
did
that.
Did he see too much?
No, he didn't see a lot. He saw pretty much... he didn't see anything.
I think he'll be taking precautions, though. I mean, even though he hasn't seen a huge amount, he's been watching Snoot play this series. He sees the Lings in the middle.
He's building a bunker, but on this map, we all know, from a Protoss perspective, Zerg Terran, whatever, the natural area is completely wide open. It's difficult to defend. But Snoot is building two additional queens here. I think this is just going to be maybe some slight pressure. Nothing too insane. We'll see. Well, 10 more Lings. Oh, 10 more Lings again.
It's, there's just so many. And he kills off the Reaper. There was even Lings up there waiting to pick that up.
A scan sees more Lings being built. He knows. At all point, Flash is like, I must know what this guy is doing. Two Worded Mines on the way. Another bunker being built. He knows that Snoot's trying to play tricky here. But
Snoot,
if he commits to this, it's not going to work.
No, he can't.
He's committing. 40 Lings. How the hell is he going to make this work here? Mine's coming in. Bunker's coming in. He's throwing so much into this. This is make or break, Claris.
This is really... How is he going to make it work? There's so on the line here. So much on the line. And there are the Banelings.
Here we go, Claris. 14 Banelings going to get morphed in. They're just slightly south here of where Flash is. He hasn't seen them yet, but he's going to catch a couple of waves here.
Uh-oh. Oh, and he instantly picks it up.
Control, the mines are back here. Lots of bunkers. Snoot's going for this.
That one Widow mine doesn't really do a whole lot.
10 drones, blocks. He's given up. He's given up. Flash is going to hold this. Flash with a scan. He knows exactly what was going on. He's going to hold this. Snoot just with wasted money, wasted units.
The Lings come back in again, but he knows that there's nothing else to be done here. This is a moment where Snoot...
Oh, perfect. This is just perfect there. Great, great defense. And another scan. He's like, okay, there are the drones being built. There's the lair coming in. Oh God, I'm good.
A strong hold by Flash when he really didn't have to do anything. Preparation alone there for Flash was enough to deter Snoot from really doing anything. And now Snoot is confined to his base. He is confined to the point where he's having to have evolution chambers rise.
Well, he best not be building too many drones, Claris, because there's 8-10 Hellions there on this front door.
That's a lot of power behind those Hellions, a lot of power. He has to be careful. He wants to break down these rocks so he has more paths to move around him, but the Hellions have found the Lings. These are free kills in the end.
Free kills, and everything is going Flash's way right now. This is so good for him. He's got his 1-1 upgrades on the way, and it's exactly like the previous two games. Snoot tries something, it doesn't work. Flash finds himself in a position where all he needs to do, play it calm, keep cool, then finish him off later on, because with 1-1 upgrades, combat shields, the medivacs, the lot, he's going to have an army, which is going to be very difficult to stop.
Ooh. Control the Hellions, control the Hellions, control the Hellions!
All right, well, mistakes happen in StarCraft, and that was one of them.
Yes, they do.
He lost every single Hellion there, and that's obviously not ideal.
Not at all. The last Hellion falls, and that now relinquishes all of Flash's map control.
Wait. Snoot is building more and more Lings. At that point, you kill off the Hellions, you don't need to be worried. I would imagine that you'd be looking to maybe drone towards that third a little bit more because it's almost ready, but he squeezes out a couple more Lings here. This is very safe with Snoot. And 1-1 Lings on the way now for him, but Flash already started 2-2. This is going to be such an advantage for Flash in these fights.
It is. It's 49 workers to 46. Look at the creep spread, though. Snoot is trying to establish himself map dominance here whilst all of this goes on. The Spire is on the way. A lot of Lings as well as Banelings in production. Are these here to just stop a push that isn't even coming right now? I mean, Flash is just happy to secure his third base back home.
Yes, he is. But Snoot is he's got his creep spread good. It's very nice and open in the middle of the map here. And there's... Well, he's continuing to do it, but I'm looking, 11 more drones on the way. I'm so worried for when the 2-2 attack comes, because I don't think there's going to be too much action for the next minute or so. Mm-hmm. But when that push makes its way across the other side of the map, that's where Snoot's going to have trouble with. But he has Baneling speed. He has very good creep spread. Yeah. These are things that will make it much easier to defend. He's even got Burrow. So this is something that we see in extreme circumstances, because if he borrows Banelings somewhere here, Flash walks over them, he gets the Great Detonation, the game turns around in an instant.
Yes. Snoot here, with those precautionary measures against this, could find a good route back into the upgrade war that's currently going on.
I mean, he's doing it, but right now he hasn't seen these two medivacs. These are going to do a lot of damage here. They can get inside the main base, they can... Well, where is Snoot's army? In the middle of the map.
Drop, now entering the base, looking for drone kills. Anything he can get here, very, very far out of position. As he goes back to clean this up, Baneling Nest is going to fall. That's Baneling. A really nice
this
position.
This is so big to get rid of the Baneling Nest, because without the Baneling Nest, there's no Banelings, and that is the key in defending against these type of pushes. This is a golden opportunity now for Flash to start to move into the middle of the map to find a way to get in there before Banelings are morphed. Currently, there is only 7. I really feel this is an optimal timing for Flash to make something work with the units he has out.
He's trying. We don't have any. He's actually supply blocked to Snoot as well during all of this, having to replenish during all of it. There's a little bit of panic mode going on for Snoot right now.
Well, the Baneling Nest is going to get back online quite fast here, so it looks like he is going to be able to, you know, not take losses within that small period against these couple of pushouts. But the game is now in the position where the 2-2 upgrades are completed. This is Flash's moment.
Yeah, this is his push. If he can actually stomp through everything that we're seeing here, as ultimately he's cleaning up the creep. He is slowly moving onto Snoot territory. He has so much supply.
Oh, a big drop in the main base here. It's caught Snoot off guard. He's got no units there. He brings him in actually at the last second, but he's going to take a lot of damage. And meanwhile, Flash just put the spawning pool. It's gone.
Uh-oh, he has to replenish. He needs Lings. He needs units out here right now to be able to deal with this.
Oh, Borat Banelings are just going to have to be the key here. This is Flash's moment. This is where Flash can go to the semifinals. Snoot's Blitz chances are going down here. This is so important. He needs to stay alive. 12 Banelings coming in, but the third is going to get broken, and Flash is making this work. Look at the supplies.
He needs to hold on. Somehow Snoot needs to hold on, but it's going to be very, very difficult. The third ends up falling. Flash here making the recovery, pushing on forwards. He was 2 games down during all of this as he now lays waste to the third base.
I think Snoot's starting to feel it. He knows that this is going out of his favor, and Flash has played a beautiful series here. 3 games in a row to turn this around. The pickoff of the Banelings.
Ladies and gentlemen, Flash makes the unbelievable recovery.
A beautiful series. That was StarCraft at its finest, Kolaris. That was beautiful.
What a series.
The crowd chanting Flash as he moves on to the semis and will go up against Liquid Tasia tomorrow. Down 2 games to win 3 in a row. Beautiful StarCraft, absolutely wonderful series from both sides, not just Flash, Snoot as well.
Snoot showing why he is one of the best non-Koreans in the world. He stood tall in that series, but unfortunately was not able to defeat Flash.
And what a series. I'm very happy to have cast that, and I'm very happy to have shared that with you guys in the crowd as well. Flash versus Snoot, a series to remember for a very, very long time. And unfortunately for Snoot, another IEM, another Intel Extreme Masters, another quarterfinal loss. And a very close series last time, Jadong, this time Flash.
Yeah.
He loses to 2 big, big names, but I'm sure Snoot is going to continue to fight. There's a lot of more tournaments coming up that he can still further his WCS points. But it is Flash at the end of the day who claims his first semi-final in a very long time.
Thanks very much, Apollo. Yes, his first ever at the Intel Extreme Masters as well. Congratulations, Flash. Let's start by talking through the match. Game 1, game 2, Snoot seemed absolutely perfect in his play. You seemed a little bit flustered. You didn't seem to be able to cope with what he threw at you. How did you turn that around from 2-0 to winning 3-2?
제 이용호 선수 일단 8강에서 또 한 스텝 더 올라가기는 축하드리고요. 일단 경기 얘기를 한번 해보자면은 1, 2경기에서는 스위트 선수가 너무 완벽한 경기력을 보여주면서 좀 탈락하는 게 아닌가, 이용호 선수는 오히려 실수도 많이 내고 이랬었는데 이제 일부러 패패승승승을 하신 건지.
예, 일단 1, 2경기 져가지고 진짜 떨어지는 줄 알았는데 그래도 일단 집중력 있게 계속 게임하면 충분히 이길 수 있다고 생각해가지고 집중력 있게 한 게 이렇게 역으로 3-2로 이길 수 있었지 않나 싶어요.
I also added on top of your question that there's a little saying every now and then when this kind of stuff happens in Korean scene, it's like, you do it on purpose because that's how you do it. That's how you advance in style. And he's like, well, no, I wasn't really going for it on purpose. But first two games, I think I was sloppy because I couldn't really focus or concentrate as hard as I could. Third game, I was like, oh, crap. One more loss and I'm gone. So he decided to, I decided to focus really hard. And that ended up paying out in the 2-3 victory.
So just focus.
Just focus.
Okay. I mean, it's an incredible feat that you have when you've played so well recently to find yourself 2-0 down to a player that you've not played before. Mentally, what goes through your mind? How did you reset? Other than just focus, what process do you go through?
이영호 선수 같은 경우에는 이제 스타크래프트 선수 하시면서 경력도 많이 쌓으셨을 거고 또 근데 이제 문제는 스타크래프트 2 대회에서는 좋은 성적을 많이 이렇게 얻으시다가 이번 같은 경우에도 2-0으로 5판 3승에서 뒤지고 계셨는데 어떤 식으로 이 2-0의 이제 압박이라든지 그 스트레스를 이기고 지금 3-2로 역전승을 할 수 있었는지.
일단 압박은 좀 받았지만 그래도 2-0이라는 숫자를 잊고 게임을 했고요. 이제부터 그냥 시작이라는 생각으로 좀 멘탈을 잡고 했는데 그래서 이길 수 있었던 것 같아요.
Pressure definitely is what a lot of people face when you're down two games in best of five series, because you lose one more, you slip once more and you're gone. But I try not to think about it. I mean, I think I can call myself veteran. So I try to forget that I was down two games and I was in the mindset of I'm not going to lose to this guy. So okay. That kind of helped. To keep the concentration level and manage to pull that off.
Okay. The crowd have been fantastic these last few days. And of all the... Yeah, you guys deserve that. I'm interested how you feel about the crowd. Being outside of Korea, I know you're used to big crowds. Pro League Final was fantastic. But you seem to be the most popular player with the crowd right now. How much does that help you?
한국에서는 이영호 선수 팬이 되게 많지만 해외는 그렇게 많이 나와보시지 않고 그리고 캐나다는 처음인데 지금 이영호 선수를 보려고 들어온 사람들이 많아요. 이제 그런 팬들이 있다는 거에 이제 뭔가 좀 버프를 받는지.
일단 팬 응원에 있어서 팬이 많으면 많을수록 더 힘이 나는 것 같고요. 그래서 오늘도 2-0 상황에서 팬들이 응원 열심히 해주셔서 집중력 있게 계속 게임했던 것 같고 항상 해외 올 때마다 느끼는 건데 진짜 해외 팬분들한테 되게 감사드려요.
I had the pleasure to meet some of the people today before the game, and they're like, yeah, I came in because I'm your fan. It was a great feeling knowing that I have some fans here, knowing that I'm being cheered on while I'm in the game is definitely a boost. It's a morale boost to stay focused in the game. And every time, I don't come to many foreign events, but every time I do, I thank you guys so much. I think you guys are all crazy. In the best possible way, and this I don't think this would have been possible if it wasn't for your supports.
There you go. Crowd power does help Flash. Flash, congratulations. He is through to his first ever Intel Extreme Masters semi-final. Can he go all the way? I think there's some believers here in the crowd for God. We'll find out very shortly who joins him in the quarterfinal tomorrow. Flash will be back to fight another day. He's just one match away from the grand final.